morning will be from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love.
Thank you. Good morning, church. You recognize those words? I'm sure, Daryl, as you were doing the wedding yesterday, you used those words. Daryl also ministered to us by serving the Lord's table, and that's all about love, and by writing a really nice article in the bulletin about love. We have so many incidences right now of love. As Silas walked into the building this morning, he heard the singing, and so guess what? He was doing this, and I know it's love from either his mother or his grandmother or his dad that taught him how to do that, and it's love that brings us all here today, even though the weather's cold and our hearts are warm because of the love that Jesus has for us. Last week, we looked at how to leave the past, leave 2015. And we talked about forgiveness, and we said before we can fully embrace the new year, we need to let go of the old. And the way to do it is a very simple concept: forgiveness. If you can truly forgive, you can move on. A man who wrote the definitive work on Southern Africa's geological structure, a man by the name of Henry Drummond, was born in 1857. And he died in 1897, only 40 years old. He'd probably be about 158 years old if he was alive today. But that's not why we know him. We know him because he wrote another book. And that book is called The Greatest Thing in the World. This is what he says. As memory scans the past. Now you can imagine him. He's just 39 years old. He realizes he's going to die pretty young. And yet he has to make the most of it. So he scans all that he's done in his life. He scans having come to Africa where people are so unbelievably poor that if you do just the slightest thing for any one of those people, they'll think it's huge. And so he thinks back on these as he writes these words. As memory scans the past, above and beyond all the transitory pleasures of life, they leap forward those supreme hours when you have been enabled to do unnoticed kindness to those around you. Things too trifling to speak about. Unnoticed kindness. Things that a normal human being would never notice. And these seem to be the things which alone of all of one's life abides. When last did you do something kind for someone? Something that nobody else will notice. When you sum up your life and you think back on your life, those are going to be the things that you'll remember. And so as we look at the new year, as we try to embrace the new year, what we're trying to do is embrace faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Now these three will survive. These three will be there when everything else has disappeared. Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. So let's talk about embracing faith by letting go of fear. Let's talk about embracing hope by letting go of guilt. Let's talk about embracing love by letting go of anger. If I had to give this lesson a different name, it would be healing deep hurts of the past. Things that you have not been able to get over. I think one of the reasons why Summit is a healthy congregation is because we talk so much about this. We talk about the peace that is ours, the joy that is ours, because we've learned to move on. We're not saying we're perfect. We're not saying that we are walking righteous without the blood of Christ. But what we are saying is we've determined to take these three concepts and move them along in our lives. So think for a moment, if you have to scan the Bible and scan your memory and think about faith, who is it that moved away from fear towards faith? Which person springs to your mind? When I think of faith and when I think about moving from fear, I think about this scripture. And if you have your Bibles, you can also open to Psalm 18, verse 2. Listen to Psalm 18, verse 2. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. The Lord is my rock. See, everything in my life can go crazy. I can be filled with ups and downs in my life. But when I think back on my life and I think about the times that I was solid, it wasn't the times that everything was working perfectly. It was the times that my faith was being tested. Or maybe I can say it was the times that my faith was being strengthened. In my life, I've had the pleasure of sitting with people who are over 100 years old. Some for very brief moments, some for quite extensive visits. Miss Almerta, I think she made it to 103. And when I would sit and talk to her and listen to what she was sharing with the people around her, she was speaking fondly about the things that currently in our lives we would say, I don't want it, I want it to pass. This is the worst time of my life. But actually, these are the times of your life when it's so tough that you're becoming so very, very strong. And so Miss Almerta would talk about the Dust Bowl. You all know what the Dust Bowl is? The Dust Bowl was particularly bad in Oklahoma. Those dry parts of the land where it seems like there's no mountains and the wind just blows across all the way from the north to the south. The wind would just blow through. You can look at many instances on the web and you can find tumbleweeds higher than what a snowbank would be in the panhandles of Oklahoma and Texas. And she would talk about those times, but not negatively. She talked positively. She talked about coming to the West in a wagon. Imagine that. And she would talk positively about that. She talked about the Great Depression as something that was really incredible. I mean, these are the ideas that would roll about in her head. And that is how you move from fear to faith. That is how you embrace faith and let go of fear when you realize that these times are actually making you really, really strong. And so in Mark chapter 5, verses 25 through 34, I imagine this lady being filled with fear, but I see her moving to faith. You see, she has had an issue of blood all her life, 12 years, sorry, and seems like every doctor that she goes to, it becomes just worse. So verse 25 says, and this is Mark 5, 25, and there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years and who had suffered much under many physicians. Does that sound like the doctors were helping her? She suffered much under many physicians. I love the way the ESV puts the word order there. And had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. Is it fair for me to say that she was experiencing fear? But then she hears this report. Jesus is there and he's going to pass by. And she thinks, you know, if only I can touch the cloak of his garment, the edge of his garment, I'll be healed. And so as the crowd is pressing in on him, she sneaks in right behind him and she reaches out and she touches the garment. And instantly, she's healed. And Jesus feels power leaving him and he turns around and he says, "Who touched me?" And the disciples say, "But Lord, the crowd is pressing on you. How can you ask who touched you?" But he looks and she sees that he's looking. And so she comes forward in fear and trembling and she tells him the whole truth. Verse 32, and he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. You get that? You want to move from fear to faith? You get down before Jesus. And you tell him the whole truth. And you will be healed of that disease, that fear that seems to immobilize you from time to time. And he said to her, listen to the piece in this scripture. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." How do we do that today? How do we allow Jesus to touch us? For some of you, this would be a new concept. For others of you, you would just not have thought it through as much as what you've needed to. When Daryl led us in the Lord's Supper today, he was leading the body of Christ. You get that? He was leading the body of Christ. The arms of Christ, the feet of Christ, is in this world. And when you have somebody that's in hospital and you go and visit with that person, put your hand on that person as the body of Christ. Christ can still touch people in this world. In James chapter 5, verses 14 and 15, it says that what you should do if you've got a sickness in you, if you've got a cacopathos, a bad spirit like fear in you, and it won't leave, it says call in the elders. And actually, call them to where you are. The elders will get in their car or they will come to wherever you are. And the Bible says, ask them to pray over you. Now, when you think about somebody praying over you, what idea comes to your mind? It says anointing them with oil. Probably a little bit of olive oil was used back then. And it says, in the name of Jesus, and the prayer of the righteous will save you. It will raise you up, and if you need sins forgiven, they will be forgiven you. That's what James says, not in the early part of the church, but this is after charismatic movement had gone through, and the spiritual gifts were now regulated to more natural talents. Still, the elders of the church could come, and they could pray over you, and in my mind, if I was elders, I would touch that person, because that person needs to be touched at that moment, and they don't need to be touched by our elders. I need to be touched by Jesus. If only I can touch the hem of his garment. There is great power, folks. There's great power. If you want to move from fear to faith, you can have it. And you can think about that lady. And you can think about your darkest hours. And you may be experiencing real tough times right now. Don't shrug them off. Turn them from fear to faith. See the hand of God in them. See his body in them. See people around you supporting you and lifting you up. Secondly, how do we move from guilt to hope? How do we let go of those things that the devil uses us just to bring us down? To let us know that we are the most worthless people in the world. That we are so unrighteous. How could we even think that Jesus would consider us? How do we move from there? Again, scan in your minds as I did when I was getting this lesson together. Who in your mind do you know move from guilt to hope? Just in one setting. How did that work out? And here is a scripture again from the Psalms. This is Psalm 71, verse 5. You are my hope, O Lord God. Not when things are going well, but any time. You are my hope. Without him, I have no hope. Without him, you have no hope. If you imagine standing before the judgment throne of God right now and you are scared, you are right. But you have hope. The hope is in the Lord God, right? In the Lord Jesus, the Son of God. You are my trust from my youth. There was a young man who said, you know what? I want to be baptized when I'm still young. I want to be with the Lord all the days of my life. If you go from Jerusalem to Jericho, there's a road called the Wadi Kelt. Back then, it was called the Valley of Shadow. It was the Valley of Shadow where David sat when he wrote Psalm 23. And again, if you have your Bibles open to Psalm 23, and look with me at verse 4. He's sitting there, and he's looking at this road. It's treacherous. It's winding. Nothing good happens there except thieves and robbers get rich. And when you go through the Wadi Kelt, or when you go through the Valley of Shadow, you have to go there with hope. You have to go there knowing that God is with you. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, your rod and your staff. They comfort me. You can go anywhere in this world and you can be okay. You can go into an environment where people are looking at you, they are judging you, and they're thinking you are the worst person in the world. Isn't it amazing how sometimes we will hold on to things that cause guilt in our own lives and in the lives of our friends and our neighbors and our family and our extended family. And we will keep on those things that is either bad in our life or in their lives. And every time that we dwell on it, or every time we talk about it, listen carefully, church, we are preaching the message of Satan. If you live in guilt, you're preaching the message of Satan. You're not a beacon of light. You can either talk about your own sins, and ask God to forgive you, and then never talk about it again, Or you can talk about your own sins as if they still currently affecting you. Or somebody else's sins. You can only confess your own sins. So don't even think about confessing your neighbor's or your family or extended family's sins. They're secrets. You know, we've all got these areas in our life that God took care of, that he just covered over, and that he removed as far as Billy from the east, from the west, right? I hear Billy say that many times. It's no longer there. You can move out of it. And here is the guy. If you'll turn to Mark chapter 2 and look at verses 14 through 17, you'll see that there is a man whose father's name is Alphaeus. His name is Levi. He's a tax collector. And he's sitting at the tax collector booth. And he's got so much to be guilty of. And his name again is Levi. And when you think about Levi, Steve, what do you think about Levi? Oh, the tribe of Levi. So he should be like a priest, right? And where is he? He's sitting there as a tax collector. Man, his name is reminding him of what he should be. And there he is. And Jesus says to him, and he says to you, follow me. And so he follows Jesus. And Jesus goes to his house. Jesus sits down at his house and they have food. And meanwhile, the story of Matthew Levi becomes Matthew, is becoming known. And all of his friends are following him in. And sinners and tax collectors are filling that house. The scribes and the Pharisees are also there. But they are there just to gossip or to confess other people's sins. They're there only to preach the message of Satan. They're there only to talk about guilt. And they say this, how can he eat with sinners? And the disciples are being questioned, and Jesus hears this. And guess what he says? Verse 16, and the scribes and the Pharisees, when they saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, said to his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? And when Jesus heard it, and when Jesus heard Satan trying to cause you to feel guilty, this is what Jesus says. Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. You know who that is? That's us. The despicable fools of the world that have no right even to call themselves children of God, except for the blood of Christ. You and I, whose feet are curled on the edge of the very precipice of hell, that if we just slip a little bit, we'll go all the way down. And there's only one that wants to remind us of that all the time, and that's the devil. Jesus came for the sick. But I wouldn't do justice if I didn't read these last words. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. Welcome home, sinners. Welcome home, people who do not feel that they're righteous, people who feel that they're inundated with sin. It's you, it's me. And it's the blood of Christ that makes us the children of righteousness. It's the blood of Christ that, according to 2 Corinthians 5 verse 20, makes Jesus sin so that we can become the children of righteousness. But that's who we are. But we have no more guilt because that guilt has been taken away. And so we can move from faith to fear. We can move from hope. We can move, away from fear to faith, move away from guilt to hope. And finally, we can move away from anger to love. Anybody here experience anger lately? A lot of strange things happening when the rain starts coming down, right? A lot of strange things happen when there's a football game at 8 o'clock at night. Where it's like disgusting and disgraceful. But thankfully, there's a man whose heart is filled with love. And he looks at all of this, and Keith says on Facebook, at least Andy Dalton can't be blamed for anything this time. And he sees the one good thing you can say out of it. Don't be filled with guilt. Don't be filled with anger. Don't be filled with fear, Just let it go. That's your resolution, right? Go into the new year forgiving. Forgiving everybody. Yes, there will be consequences to actions, and that's right. But for us, we're not hanging around to see consequences. We're not hanging around to dwell on those negative things that cause us to be angry. We look at those things of love. There was a lady who ordered 3 plaques to put on the wall of her house. Faith, hope, and love. The first one had already arrived, love, and it was proudly up on the wall, and there were 2 places ready for the next 2 for hope. but hope was still to come. It was on back order. Faith was still to come. It was on back order. Love was already there. And that's what we need. We need love first. Before you can have faith, before you can have hope, you need love. In 1 Corinthians 7, verse 7, we have the word faith mentioned there. But it's actually the word belief. But it's belief in the verb. So when you have belief in the verb or faith in the verb, it's the word trust. And that's what faith is when you make it a working word. It's trust. We are here today because of the blood of Christ, and we have faith in it. And we actually trusted that by actually taking the Lord's Supper this morning. And becomes part of us when we look at these. So love comes first, and then the rest will follow. So scan in your Bibles. Scan in your mind. Who moved from anger to love? Which person jumps out at you? I'm sure, Jack, you can think of quite a few cases. But the one that really jumped out at me was Acts chapter 9. Saul, right? Breathing murderous threats against the Christians. He went back to the high priest and said, "Can I please have a letter so that I can take them back to Jerusalem, bound hand and foot, both men and women?" And here is Saul. I mean, he's already murdered Stephen. He was the one responsible. He was standing there. It was at his feet that the clothes of Stephen was laid after Stephen had been killed. He was doing a lot of evil in Jerusalem. And now he was following the gospel up. For those people that fled from Jerusalem, they had fled to Damascus. And so now he wants letters to go into Damascus to bring these people back. And as he's on his horse and he's riding on his donkey or whatever he was on, there's this bright light that comes down from heaven and it throws him down and he's on the ground. And listen to what the voice says to him. "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Now, when I looked earlier on, it said that what he was actually doing is he went to Damascus, so he found people belonging to the way. It says that he was persecuting, in verse 1, the disciples of the Lord. The people of the way, that was the first word that the Church of Christ was given. The first name of the church was the people of the way. And here this guy is, and he's persecuting the people of the way. He's persecuting disciples. Who are disciples? Anybody know who disciples are? Before we were called Christians, we were called what? Disciples. You know who disciples are? You are disciples. But when Jesus appears to him, what does Jesus say? "Why are you persecuting the people of the way? Why are you persecuting disciples?" Or does he say, "Why are you persecuting me?" He says, "Why are you persecuting me?" And down on the ground, he says, "Who are you, Lord?" And Jesus says to him, "I am Jesus, who you are persecuting. You're persecuting Jesus. Why?" Now again, as I began, you might not have fully grasped this. The penny might not have completely dropped, but I want it to drop right now. I want you to get this. You are the body of Christ. You are Jesus in this world. And if people hurt you, they're actually hurting Jesus. You know, if my head is in heaven and my big toe's on earth and somebody takes a sledgehammer and hits my big toe, what's my head going to do? It's going to know about that pain, right? And so Saul of Tarsus is led to Damascus. He's blind. He's not eating, drinking, nothing for 3 days. And in a vision, Jesus comes to a person called Ananias and he calls him by his name. He says, "Ananias." And Ananias says, "Yes, Lord." And Jesus in a vision tells him that there is a man on the street called Straight in the house of Judas. He's in that house and you need to go there and you need to pray over him so he may receive sight. Because he's seen in a vision that you're going to do this. "Oh, I can't do that. I know this man. He has done a lot of evil in Jerusalem. I mean, he's taking people bound hand and foot back to, he's got letters. You want me to do this? He is my chosen vessel. I will show to him just how much he must suffer for me. He will be my messenger to Gentiles. He might be my messenger to kings. He will be my messenger to the Jews. Obviously, he's going to suffer. If that's your audience, you're going to know about suffering. And he goes, follows what Jesus says, goes to the street called Straight, goes to the house of Judas. He prays over Saul, and things like scales falls from his eyes, and he can see. And the first thing that he does is he is baptized, and he eats, and he spends some time with the Christians in Damascus. People who are there because of him, right? They fled Jerusalem to Damascus because of him. That is how you turn from being an angry person. Let me read verse 1 again. But Saul still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. That's how you move from anger to love. You never have to be angry again. You can get rid of that part of your life completely if you would want to. Yesterday, just as the sun was starting to set, the wind said, you know, we got some lamb chops. Why don't you put them out in the fire? So I got the gas going, and I asked her, well, you know, it was just before 5. I said, why now? You know, we only need to be at the building at 8 because we didn't want to arrive too early. And she says, because the sun is going to go down. And it seems like the darker it becomes, the dearer light is. Friday evening, I was driving by the building. The wind was driving behind me in the other car. And she said, your lights aren't working. I went straight to the spare store and stopped in there and got a bulb. And the first thing I did when I got home is I put on a very bright light, and I got in my car and I changed out the light, because when it's dark, light becomes dearer. It seems like the longer we live in this world, the fonder our love becomes. Right, Daryl? I remember there was a couple, and they were both dying. He was dying of pancreatic cancer, and she was dying of Parkinson's. They'd been married for over 50 years, and this is what happened right near the end of their lives. Barbara leaned over Claude's bed, kissed him, and whispered, I love you. Claude replied, you're beautiful. It seems like the longer we live in this life and the darker this world becomes, the brighter love shines and the more dearer love becomes. Maybe today you feel like you're standing on the very precipice of hell. Maybe you feel like any second you can fall in. Maybe it's because that's a fact. Maybe it's because you've stepped out of the righteousness of God. And the blood of Christ cannot affect you where you are because you've walked away. And maybe you legitimately need the elders of this church to pray over you. You know your heart. You know what Jesus has just told you. You can let go of that fear, guilt, and anger, and you can embrace faith, hope, and love. And you can do it today. You don't have to go another day. Maybe you've looked at all of this and, like Saul, you're ready to make that commitment. You're ready to take Jesus on, and you're ready to be baptized. That was Paul's first act as a believer. He believed that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He believed that he was persecuting him. And because he figured it out, I think he got some help. The first thing he did is realized he needed to be baptized. In other words, he realized he needed to get rid of his body, the body of sin, the spirit that lives inside of it, and he needed to bury it so that when he resurrected, the spirit that would come into him would no longer be that spirit of death, but it would be the spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why you and I today are the body of Christ. Because we no longer have that old spirit. We have the spirit of Jesus living inside of us. If you want to be baptized today, there's no better time to put on Jesus, to put off the old. If you need to come forward for the presence of church, why don't you consider doing it right now? I know that it's cold outside, but the water's warm, right, Dan? Water's perfect. Please do so right now. Come forward as together we stand and sing.
Well, certainly it's good to see everybody here on kind of a, you know, a snowy, blowing Sunday evening. Appreciate so very much your faithfulness to be here tonight. It speaks a lot of you and says a lot about your character and the kind of person that you are and your dedication to Christ. So appreciate you being here tonight. Tonight we're looking at Luke chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. So if you have your Bibles, you might want to turn there. That's kind of what we'll be referencing tonight to kind of set the stage for our lesson. Luke chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. In this text, Jesus is returning to his home synagogue. So I kind of think about that. It's been a while since I've gone back to my home congregation in Indianapolis. But in the past, when I've gone back, it's kind of special to go back to the congregation where you grew up. And so that's what Jesus is doing here. He's going back, a place he had studied as a boy, a place that he had worshiped on the Sabbath in the past. As was the custom for the reader, Jesus stood to read from the prophet Isaiah. And so the scroll of Isaiah would have been presented to Jesus. And I think this says a lot about Jesus and obviously his familiarity with the scriptures. Obviously, chapters and verses didn't come into effect until hundreds of years later. And so Jesus knew immediately within a scroll exactly where he had to go to read the text from Isaiah that he was going to read. And Jesus reads from Isaiah what we now know as chapter 61, verses 1 and 2, and Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 6. And so let's look here at Luke to see what he read, verses 18 and 19. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are downtrodden, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. Jesus was saying this, and he was saying he was the fulfillment of this prophecy. In fact, in case someone wasn't clear that he was speaking about himself, he was just so clear that the people wanted to stone him after he had read this and indicated it was referencing him. He was claiming he was the fulfillment of the prophecy. Jesus brings deliverance to those who are enslaved, those who are enslaved. And the prophecy of Isaiah did concern Jesus. This evening, as we have just read this passage, there are many folks who are in prison. And I'm not talking about the Boone County Jail or the Kenton County Jail or the Campbell County Jail, although there are people who are in prison there tonight. And I'm not talking about way over in Western Kentucky, Eddyville, the maximum security prison for males in the state of Kentucky. And I'm not talking about Pee-wee Valley, which to me is a really odd name for a prison, where women are held in confinement in the state of Kentucky. I'm not talking about those prisons and those penitentiaries. We're not necessarily talking about individuals who are physically imprisoned. You see, not all prisoners are behind stone walls or iron gates. Somebody might ask, what makes a prison a prison? Is it the guard towers, the security guards? Is it the cells, the electric fences? Is it the steel doors that make a prison a prison? That's not the kind of prison that I'm talking about tonight. We as Christians often make our own prisons that entrap us. Prisons with bars that are stronger than iron. You may remember, obviously, last month was December, and there was a lot of talk about this, Charles Dickens' novel, Scrooge. Jacob Marley, who was Scrooge's deceased business partner, comes back to haunt him. He's wearing a chain wrapped around him. And he's making loud noises as he walks. It's sort of a clank, clank, clank as he walks along. He's wailing and he's moaning. And Scrooge asks Jacob Marley, "Why these chains? Why are you in these chains?" And this is what Marley says in response. "I wear the chain that I forged in life. I wear the chain that I forged in life. He forged his own prison link by link in life. We forge our own chains, and build our own prisons that enslave us." And so, who holds the key to our prison? Well, Jesus Christ, obviously, is the one who holds the key to your own self-imprisonment. And tonight, what I want to do is, I want to look at four or five common prisons that we as Christians build for ourselves. And again, these aren't prisons that have walls of stone and gates of steel or gates of iron. They're prisons we forge. But they can be just as strong as those physical prisons, and they can entrap us and prevent us from being what Christ wants us to be. The first prison I want to talk about tonight is the prison of inferiority. The prison of inferiority. To be inferior means that you have low quality or some kind of a lower status. I want to focus on one particular gender as I talk about this point tonight. Often women feel this way, and I'm not making a sexist remark. Research bears this out. But I think that the reason that this is the case sometimes is that men don't help the matter in how women are treated. The wife is to be subject to the husband. The wife is to realize that the husband is the head of the home. But the husband should take his role very seriously. He should be very sober about this huge responsibility and burden that he has to be the leader of his home. But subjection does not equal less significant or less important. That's true in the home, that's true in the workplace, and that's true in the church setting. There are some men who believe that women are less important, and as a result of that, they mistreat the weaker vessel. They abuse the weaker vessel. In fact, in my time in the church, I can tell you of situations where a man referred to his wife as woman. Woman, get me a drink. Woman, get me some food out of the refrigerator. Woman, do this for me. Woman, do that for me. Now, when someone treats their spouse like that, it may cause someone to feel inferior. And that's not what subjection is all about. That's not what Paul intended when he spoke in Ephesians chapter 5. There are some men who are dominant. They are dictators in the home. And when they do that, and they somehow appeal to Scripture as a justification to act that way, they are misusing Ephesians chapter 5. As a result, some women feel that they are not worthy, that they are not as good as a man. And that often leads to depression and low self-esteem. Jesus became submissive to the Father. Was he less than the Father? No. He was and he is equal to the Father. There are role distinctions in the Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they all have unique roles and unique functions, yet they are all equal and they are all one. In a marriage situation where you have two genders, a man and a woman, they're both equal before God, equal with each other, and yet there are role distinctions that God has clearly set up. In fact, I would argue that part of the problems that we see in our society today, and perhaps even in the church, is when men don't act like men, and women don't act like women. In fact, in our society today, we have too many men acting like women. And in some cases, we have too many women who are acting like men. God has given wonderful roles to both women and men. And when we don't fulfill those God-given roles, when somehow we feel that they are less than, that contributes to all sorts of chaos, both in the church and in the home. In Matthew 28 and verse 20, Jesus said, "I am with you always." He was talking to us. Christ is with both men and women. Christ died because he believed that men and women were and are valuable. They were worth dying for. Paul wrote in Philippians 4:13, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." And that's true in regards to either gender. Jesus is the key to inferiority. In the bulletin article this week that I wrote, I talked about how some religious faiths suppress women. Christianity liberates women. And so Jesus is the key to any sense of inferiority that someone may feel. Second prison tonight is the prison of hatred. Hatred is a problem that many folks experience. Many people's lives are filled with bitterness, grudges, attitudes. Attitudes against members of our physical families. And sometimes people hold grudges and attitudes and are indifferent to people who are members of their church family. In my years as a preacher, I visited people who do not go to church anymore. And it's not uncommon for someone to say, "Well, someone upset me. Someone offended me. Someone said something to me that I didn't like. It hurt my feelings. And so I don't want anything to do with the church. I don't want anything to do with Christian people." I remember when I was in college and I was preaching in Tennessee. I think both these people are dead now. But there was a brother and sister that went to the same congregation. They were both older. And they had had some sort of feud about some property in their family. And whenever he was serving the Lord's Supper and was passing the emblems down the aisle, if she was sitting in the aisle, he would not pass the emblems to her because of his attitude and his hatred and his bitterness to his own flesh and blood. But not just his flesh and blood, right? His sister in Christ as well. There are many folks like that. There are folks who've written something down that happened months ago, years ago, and they've never forgotten it. They've written it down in their imaginary black book. I love how one translation renders 1 Corinthians chapter 13 when it says, "Love doesn't hold a record book." Love doesn't hold a record book. It doesn't keep an accounting of wrongs suffered. Has anybody ever offended you? Yes. Has anybody ever said something to you that rubbed you the wrong way? Yes. But love doesn't hold a record book. Love doesn't keep a ledger sheet of the wrongs against us. But there are folks who hold on to it. It's my hatred, but it will eat you alive. You've got to let it go. You've got to put differences of opinion behind you and move on. We've got to love each other and let others love you. There are some people who have a hard time doing that, letting others love them. We've got to be more tolerant with each other. We've got to be more understanding with each other. And here's part of the problem. It's kind of base. Sometimes we just don't communicate very well, right? I mean, sometimes we just don't. How many times have you gone home and said, "Did I really say that? I didn't mean to say that." Or maybe you ask your spouse, "I said this to somebody," and she says to you or he says to you, "Really, you said that? I don't think I would have said that if I were you." But you didn't think at the time. You opened your mouth and you inserted your foot, right? We've all done that. We've got to give each other the benefit of the doubt. Oh, if we could, how much better off we would be. We've got to give some room for when people have bad moods, right? You know, there are some Wednesday nights when you're here at church, or some Sunday nights, or some Sunday mornings, when you're just not in a good mood, right? And somebody comes up to you and they're all happy and joyous, and you know, and you just don't feel like dealing with people like that, right? You're just not in the mood. And so sometimes it rubs someone the wrong way. We've got to give some slack. We've got to give room for mistakes. We have to do that in a marriage. How much more we've got to do that in our church body. In Matthew 5, 43 through 44, Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said," it never really said that in the law, "you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you." If we are to love our enemies, what does that say about our relationship with our fellow Christians? That's some meat we need to chew on. And there's some gristle in that meat, right? We've got to chew on that. Jesus is the key to the prison of hatred. Then there's the prison of superstition. The prison of superstition. Many people are superstitious more than they would care to admit. There's hardly a human being that doesn't harbor a few superstitions, either consciously or subconsciously. Do you walk under a ladder? Well, I don't, because it may fall on me, right? Are you the kind of person that when you're walking on a sidewalk, you want to make sure you don't step on a crack because you may break your mother's back? Do you remember? Have you heard that one before? Or maybe you try to avoid black cats or broken mirrors or spilt salt or the number 13. In fact, so concerned are most people, as you know, that most hotels and buildings don't have a 13th floor. In fact, they'll rename it 13A, or they'll just skip it and go on to 14. It makes me wonder, doesn't anybody realize that floor 14 is really floor 13? There's all that. And even though we don't really write letters anymore, remember chain letters? People still do that with email, don't they? You've got to pass this on to so many people. If you don't pass this on to so many people, then something's going to happen to you. We scoff at other cultures. For instance, when you look at the superstitions of those in Africa and in Asia, Zambians believe that eggs can cause people to be sterile. The Japanese have superstitions about cutting their nails at night. They believe if they cut their nails at night, cat claws will grow in their place, so they don't cut their nails at night. Chinese voyagers never turn over the fish on their plates because they believe it may capsize their ships. And yet, in our culture, we, although we would say that's silly and that's goofy, we're very superstitious people. You may remember several years ago that Don Regan, who was White House Chief of Staff under President Reagan, he was fired, and he wrote a tell-all book, and in that book he talked about how Nancy Reagan, oftentimes when Ronald Reagan had to fly on trips, she would consult an astrologer to make sure that all the flights lined up with the signs of the zodiac. The President of the United States, his wife was consulting an astrologer. Did you know that over $50 million are spent annually in the United States on astrology alone? And all of us know that most newspapers and magazines have a horoscope, right? And there are lots of people who read those faithfully. I'll never forget, several years ago, there was a newspaper that decided that after it ran its horoscopes for 1 year, the next year it would run the same horoscopes again and see if anybody noticed. Guess what? Nobody noticed, right? And even in our culture, even in weddings, we went to a wedding yesterday, and we have all these superstitions. Now, traditions are one thing, but a lot of times we feel like if you don't follow the tradition, something bad's going to happen, right? So we often say, the groom can't what? Can't see the bride. Oh no, he saw the bride. That's what? Bad luck. What does that mean exactly? Right? Bad luck. Or the bride has to wear something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue, right? The English add also and a sixpence in her shoe. So, I mean, that's fine to have traditions, but there are people who say, do you have those things on? Because if you don't have those things on, that's bad luck, right? Or the bride and the groom have to make sure they're the first ones to cut the cake. Otherwise, it's bad news. It's some kind of, you know, curse upon them. Or we don't do it as much today, but used to be we throw rice. There was a time we threw rice at weddings, right? And that was sort of a fertility custom. It was actually based in fertility. And so if you don't throw rice or you don't do those kind of things, sometimes that's bad luck. You know, it's important that we be careful about that, whether it's saying you didn't make a wish when you blew out your birthday cake, or you need to pull on the wishbone for good luck, or tossing a coin into a wishing well, or knocking on wood, or crossing our fingers for good luck, or making sure we don't open an umbrella where? Inside, right? All those things. Now, I know some of those things are goofy and we joke about those, but there are some people who try to map out their life based on whether or not they do certain things. There really are people like that. And so if something bad happens to them today, they go, oh no, I broke my compact this morning, and that's why bad things are happening to me. You know, I didn't cross my fingers for good luck. I found a four-leaf clover. I'm going to have a great day, right? That's all superstition. And honestly, we should be careful about that as Christians. John chapter 8 and verse 32, Jesus said, you shall know the what? The truth, and the truth shall set you free. Not superstition, not voodoo, right? Paganism in the Old Testament was belief in something other than God. And so if you're putting your belief in superstitious things, you've really displaced your belief in God. Jesus is the key to the prison of superstition. Fourth, the prison of self-satisfaction. Everything's fine. I know enough Bible verses. I pray every time I eat a meal. I attend all the major services of the church. I do plenty. When they sing "Just As I Am" at church, I go, that's right, just as I am. I'm fine just as I am, all right? I don't need to change. I'm not going to change, just as I am. If someone were to ask me to grade myself as a Christian, I'd probably give myself a 85%, maybe a 90%, maybe an A- or a B+. Is that good enough? What commitment does Jesus want from us? Does he want 85%, 90%? Is that good? 75%? He wants what? All of us. He wants 100% of us. Nothing less than that. The Christian life is about change. It's about growing. It's about expanding our horizons. In 1 Peter 2:2, Peter writes, like newborn babes, what? Long for the pure milk of the word, that by it you may grow in respect to your salvation, that you may grow, that you may develop. Christ is the key to the prison of self-satisfaction. Sometimes that's a problem in congregations where we're just kind of at ease at Zion, right? We're just satisfied with the status quo. And then fifth and finally tonight, the prison of sin. Each of these prisons, as we said earlier tonight, we make for ourselves, and the prison of sin is no different. Sin is a separator. It separates us from God. Again, back to Isaiah 59 and verse 2, Isaiah says, but your iniquities, your sins, your trespasses have made a separation between you and your God. and your sins have hidden his face from you, so he does not hear. You mean when I sin stubbornly in my own will, that God actually separates himself from me and he will not hear me, he will not listen to me? That's what the scriptures say. How valuable is your relationship with God? Do you think it's important to have a good relationship with God in order to go to heaven? And yet if I persist in sin, God will not hear me. God separates himself from me. Romans 8 and verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. Jesus is the key to the prison of sin. In conclusion tonight, I want to share with you a secret, but it's not really a secret. In Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will dine with him and he with me. Here's the secret that really isn't a secret. Jesus has already unlocked the door to your prison. All you have to do is what? Open it. If you stay there, it's by your own volition. You've made that decision. Jesus has unlocked the door to your prison cell. He is the key. You just have to open it. And so if you remain in inferiority, you've made that choice. If you remain being a person of bitterness and hatred, you've made that choice to do that because the door can be opened. If you remain living in superstition and blaming everything in life on karma and bad luck and your horoscope, then you've remained in that prison of your own choice. If you stay with the status quo and you don't grow and you don't develop as a Christian, that's a decision that you have made. If you stay in sin as well. Do you want to come out? Do you want to come out tonight and open that door? It's unlocked. You just need to pull it open. Jesus is waiting for you. He wants to accept you and he wants to help you overcome these prisons. And you may need help to overcome these prisons. Even if you're a Christian, you may need the help of your brothers and sisters in Christ. You may need the strength of pulled together prayer to get you through those prisons. Tonight, if you need to become a New Testament Christian by being immersed in water to have your sins washed away, that's the first step to get out of that prison of sin. And then we can chip away at these other prisons. But perhaps you are a Christian, and you look at your life, and you've stuck yourself in this prison cell. You can get out. And we want to pray with you and for you. If we can help in any way tonight, won't you? Please come forward while together we stand and sing to encourage.